car accident. Terrible situation. Is Pat out of town, Dawn?
No, she's coming.
Okay. Stella. She also requests prayers for Melissa. Stella's family, of course, this time's grieving. And Larry. For those in Muskota. Good to see Danny here. And John, Teresa. Let's open up with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this day. Thank you for the weather, that it's not snow on the ground, it's been mild, and that we are able to gather here in the comforts of this building and worship you. We pray now that you would bless us this hour. Help us open our eyes and forget about the cares of this world and look to your word, which is everlasting, which is the thing that sustains us. And we ask you to be with those that are sick and that are on our minds, for those that are grieving this hour, that you would place us in your caring hands. For it's in Jesus we pray, amen. We're in lesson number 8 in the workbook. If you have a workbook with you, in Foundations, lesson number 8, and this title is Joseph at Potiphar's House. Hopefully, I got that right. And we are mainly going to be in Genesis 39 today. Covers Genesis 39 and 40. Really concentrate on the house here. And as we normally do, we're going to read. And traditionally, we start off with Gene. So let's read the scriptures. Genesis 39, 1 through 23. Genesis 39, we're reading.
Now Potiphar had sent down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites, who had taken him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord had made all he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and served him. Then he made him overseer of his house and all that he had put under his authority.
That the Lord blessed the Egyptian house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field. Thus he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he did not know what he had except for the bread when he ate. Now Joseph was a handsome in form and appearance, and it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph, and he said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to her, "Master's wife, look, my master does not know what it is with me in the house, and he committed all that he has to my hands.
Nor has he kept back anything from me, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin?" Was, as he spoke to Joseph day by day, that he did not heed her or to be with her. But it happened about this time when Joseph went to work, and none of the men of the house was inside, that he came, "Lie with me." But he left his garment inside.
And so it was when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and fled outside. And spoke to them, saying, "See, he has brought into us a Hebrew to mock us." I cried out with a loud voice, and I lifted my voice and cried out that he left his garment outside. So she kept his garment with her till his master came home.
Then she spoke to him with words like these, saying, "Hebrew servant, whom you brought to us. What happened as I lifted my voice and cried outside? So it was, spoke to him, saying, "Your servant was aroused."
And he was there, and he was there, and the Lord and showed him mercy. And the keepers of commitment, whatever they did, look into anything. And whatever he did, the
Lord. All right, thank you. Sorry about that. I cut off the last little bit of scripture there on the screen. So we're at Joseph at Potiphar's house. And just a review a few minutes here where we're at is last time we looked at Genesis 37. And at the end of that story, his brothers took him and threw him into a pit. And they sat down while he was in the pit and eated bread. And then, behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels. And they were on a trade route to Egypt, bearing spices and balm and myrrh. And there they passed by the Midianites, the merchantmen. And they pulled Joseph out of the pit, and they sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites. So that's what happens for how much? 20 pieces of silver. And that's going to be significant, isn't it? Reuben returns to the pit, and Joseph was not in the pit anymore. And fast forward, they returned and said, "The child is not. Where did he go?" And they took Joseph's coat, and they killed a kid and dripped blood on it. So that's kind of what happens after our last lesson. Now, what's significant about the 20 shekels of silver there?
Was that what the
say, I missed that one. They were going to bring me something. That was close, though. Yeah. 20 shekels of gold actually represents, if you go to Leviticus 27:5, the payment for a slave. So they actually paid him and put him into slavery, is what that would be. That was the exchange for a slave. So imagine that Joseph is thrown in the pit. Instead of letting him die there, the brothers wrenched him out of there and got 20 shekels of silver, or the payment for a slave. So there's some significance here, as I'm going to say probably a couple times as we look at this story today. Joseph represents a foreshadowing of something that's going to come. Ultimately, of course, that foreshadowing is Jesus. But there is some other foreshadowing that's coming here. Slavery, bondage. What's that remind us of? And as we look at this story of Genesis now, the rest of Genesis really depicts the story of Joseph, doesn't it? So we see an allegory. Somewhat like a metaphor, an allegory is a physical story that kind of depicts a spiritual understanding. As God is a spirit, it's hard for us sometimes to understand the spiritual nature of God. So he tells us stories in the physical nature so that we can help understand that the Messiah, as the whole Old Testament points to, we see it here again, the figure of a Messiah is going to come and take Israel, the nation, out of the bondage of sin. And notice that's what's going to happen. The 12 tribes here are represented. As we've looked in some of our past lessons, we've looked at the Jacob and the 12 tribes of Israel now. And we know at the end of this story, we're going to see a change in pharaohs, and in Exodus, we're going to see them go into bondage, aren't we? And that's certainly the allegory that we face today. There are many of us that are under a bond, not to say us, but there are many that we know are under a bondage today of sin. And they can be released from that. That's a good story to tell. There's blood here, just like we see in the future. So all these things are very significant that we can often read through and pass over. Looking at a little bit of background here, the Ishmaelites, alternately, and this is where I get confused, are called the Midianites, are descendants of Ishmael. Who is Ishmael?
Isaac's brother.
Isaac's brother, the oldest son of Abraham. Remember, he was supposed to get the the blessing. And Jacob rents his clothes, which is a normal sign for mourning. He puts sackcloth on his loins. In other words, he covers himself with ashes. For many days, he's in mourning. He's under the understanding. He's been deceived. Notice Jacob the deceiver here is being deceived. There's another irony there. One of his titles, of course, as we talked about last week, Jacob is also the supplanter. He's the one that, the heel catcher. He's the one that grabbed the heel of his older brother. And as I said in the communion thoughts last week, Jesus is our heel catcher. He caught the heel of Satan for us. And he replaced us where we should be instead and took the ultimate sacrifice for us that we deserve. So a lot of allegory there that we could spend the rest of the morning unpacking and developing. In Genesis 37:35, all of his sons, daughters rose up to comfort Jacob. Quite a clan. But he refused to be comforted. And he said, I'll go down to the grave and to my son for mourning. And this was something that is often still done today. People will lay on these graves and weep for their son. Imagine the other brothers standing around knowing this was all a ruse, watching their father go through this. Now, remember too, these were half-brothers of Joseph. Joseph would have a full brother, Benjamin, but he's not in the picture at this moment. So they don't have much compassion for him as we looked at previous lessons. Except for, it seems that Reuben has some compassion for him. And we're going to see further on, Judah is going to be blessed as the line. He's there. But they all witness this. But meanwhile, the Midianites sold him. This is Joseph in verse 36, chapter 37, into Egypt unto Potiphar, which is where our story opens up today. And he is the captain of the guard. So here's Potiphar with his wife that we don't know her name, but she's going to be a central picture here. Again, we're going to see Joseph tested, tempted. And as I was studying this and reflecting on this lesson, he seems to be without flaw. Now, in the last lesson, we found out he was a tattletale. Right? That's what we would call our brothers or sisters. But other than that, we don't really see much character flaw in him. He seems to be quite a boaster, this Joseph. Quite confident, but as a 17-year-old, as we saw in last week's lesson, not unusual. But he is sold into slavery, and the Egyptians, as they go through or buying spices and all this stuff, they notice this slave person. And Potiphar notices him, and we're going to talk about that in a second. Potiphar, every name is important in the Bible. We've looked at God has many names. They're all very significant. Potiphar seems to be devoted to the sun, is one of the renderings which the Egyptians worshiped the sun. They worshiped the moon and the stars and all these things. And so we see a local deity or Heliophas that he might have been named after, which he's in the delta region of the Nile. And he's a district bordering Canaan. So we're south of Canaan here. And he's literally the prince of Pharaoh. So he's in the service of Pharaoh's government, is what we find out here. So he's the captain of the guard. Sometimes it could mean he's chief cook. Other times he's inspector of the plantation. But it seems here that Potiphar might be the chief of the executioners. He might be the captain of the watch. And so we see that what happens here, the Egyptians, bless you, brother, the Egyptians would go through and pillage countries, and what do they take back? They take back slaves. They need people to work. And so there would be slaves from conquering, and there would also be slaves from these trade routes that they would purchase. In this case, it seems that Potiphar bought himself a slave, and it could be that he noticed the appearance of this Hebrew, and his intelligence might have come off quickly. He seemed to be in command of his faculties, and so Potiphar somehow is at the market and decides he needs a steward for his house, and so he picks Abraham or Joseph. Why did I say Abraham? So he's in the house of the master. As we said, those slaves that were around in this prison that he was probably close to, these slaves would be sent to the labor field. They'd be subject to hard treatment, subject to the stick of the taskmasters. Those that were bought for money, though, it seems, might have been employed for domestic purposes. So there's probably women slaves in the house of Potiphar, too, or that we don't know. But it seems that Potiphar would give Joseph a little bit of upper status. And that he might be noticed as somebody that had some ability to take care of the household, given some liberty in the house of Potiphar. Potiphar must have noticed a lot of things with Joseph that he liked, and so he allows him to go into the household of Potiphar and really become a confidential servant, maybe one of the chiefs. But Potiphar notices in a new area. And sometimes we can get into a different area, a different world, and forget our boundaries and limitations, but Joseph carries on and reminds us of scripture that I think is in your commentary, that we are not to be men pleasers, but we're servants of Christ. We're doing the will of God. So Joseph shows this foreshadowing as he's doing the will of God. He's not there to please Potiphar or the Egyptians. And even though he's been put in this terrible circumstances and he would have every ability to be resentful, mad at God, mad at his brothers, harbor all this animosity, he does none of those things as far as we can tell. And so what he's doing, and now he's in bondage, the family he came from we take for granted, but Jacob was rich. Jacob was blessed by God. He had all kind of people Jacob did working for him. And maybe we might even clarify some of those people as servants. And Joseph, we know from past lessons, was well favored by Jacob. He was the golden child, we might say. And now he's thrown into slavery by his own brothers, really. But he does not hold any of those character traits that we might see in normal humans like ourselves. And so the idea is that whatever we do, we are doing it heartily for the Lord, not unto men. And so those kind of things we've heard before in lessons, I'm sure if you're like me, that when we go to work, Monday is usually a tough day for me, and I could certainly go in with a bad attitude. But if I think about what I'm doing for everything I'm doing really is to give glory for God, then even my little mundane job can be pleasing to the Lord, right? As we see in Romans chapter 12, that everything we do should be in the service. It should be our reasonable service. It's Romans 12 or 10. I always get that mixed up which chapter, but it's our reasonable service. It's our reasonable duty. And knowing that we shall receive an inheritance from God. So another allegory here, Joseph must have had some of this in mind, knowing that he would receive a greater inheritance than what anything Potiphar or the Egyptians might offer. But again, notice where he's at. He's working now for the right-hand man to Pharaoh, and we know where this story's going. We've read it before. These things still do not influence him. There are many different gods around. Potiphar's named after a god, apparently. Potiphar's giving a big position. And Potiphar, it says in 39:6, left everything, and that's where we're at in our lesson today. He leaves everything in Joseph's hand. So imagine this. He's a servant. And now, all of a sudden, he's given full reign of Potiphar's domain. And Potiphar might be likened to him in a way that Potiphar was certainly given good status by the Pharaoh. And the Pharaoh was one of many pharaohs in a line like Caesar's. They were thought of as gods too. And so Joseph finds himself in this household running as the top servant for the top person there in Pharaoh's household. And Potiphar's got a special service. He's in charge of what we think is the prison camp there. Those people that were brought in from the pillage of war. The Egyptians were the powerhouse of the area. They had the troops, the chariots and things. If not at this time, certainly it will develop into that. They were the powerhouse of the world. So it'd be easy And I want to emphasize this for Joseph to be influenced by these people. But he's not. And then we enter into and we move fast to a situation where he is tempted. And his response in 39:9 there is, there's none greater than this house than I, neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God, is what he's going to say here. 39:9. So as this, we jump to this part of the story here. Potiphar's wife is engaging him now in something that he knows is not right. And he says, I have full reign of everything here except for you. And your husband has given me everything except for you. Why would I throw all that away? And not only that, sin against God. Now, who knows what she thinks of God? But notice here, I think it's significant that he doesn't say my God, because it's probably not her God. But he brings this point out as God. The omnipresent God, the only God that there is really out there. So the advancement of, it says, and I read some background on this, he's a domestic slave, and it wasn't uncommon for these slaves to move upward in the household as they continue to work within the confines and the merits of the household owner. And so it would be actually, if the slave within the house wasn't moving up, there's something that the owner of the house, Potiphar, wasn't doing right. So he had extraordinary advancement to be given all this reign within a short amount of time, it seems. And on the other hand, Potiphar's wife has this constant opportunity to meet Joseph. She's probably has the life of leisure. I'm sure she doesn't handle the vacuum cleaner or the mop. Doesn't do any dusting on her own. Everything's probably given to her. And so she looks at Joseph as just another object. Apparently the ancient women of Egypt had loose morals. Their vices prevailed among them as they worshiped gods. These gods didn't teach them anything about morality. And Potiphar's wife, it seems, probably wasn't any worse than other women of this age. And again, Joseph was looked at as just another object in the home to use. And Potiphar, he says, wields no more house authority here than I do, except that I answer to my God. Unless Joseph, then, his answer is that his allegiance is to God and Potiphar, which in the scriptures we read in Ephesians and Colossians would also reflect this very same thing. We have allegiance to our bosses, our stewards over what we attend to, but we also answer to God. So it came to pass as she spake to Joseph day by day, she continues to entreat him to lie with her. So this is just not one occasion, apparently. This is a constant thing that goes on. Finally, she gets tired of this, and she catches him by the garment and becomes very direct with him. And he flees. What are we supposed to do, according to the New Testament, when we see the appearance of evil? What should have Eve done in the garden if she saw the appearance of evil? We are to flee, aren't we? There are some things that we engage into that we probably shouldn't because they lend to the appearance of evil. And we often justify them as that that's okay. We can not be tempted there. But the Bible teaches us to flee. But notice he didn't get away with everything. She got a hold of his garment. Now, their dress was different than ours, and they had these flowing cloths. Why do you think they had layers of cloths and garments at this, in this area? There's a practical reason. It was a very tropical and warm climate. And so actually layering up in cotton and these actually cools you down. Kind of the opposite of my thinking. And then it goes on, the story, that she came to pass. When he heard that, lifted up her voice and cried, that he left his garment with me and fled and got out of him. And she laid a garment upon her until the Lord came home. So until Potiphar comes home, she keeps this garment. Now she's mad, and she's going to use this against him. So she has the garment. Then she says out loud, the Hebrew servant, which you brought into the house, came to me to mock me. Okay, what do we say about the word? That might be in your commentary, Hebrew. What did that mean? Notice she uses an adjective here to describe him. This is back from another lesson that we covered many moons ago. But what does Hebrew mean? Anybody remember? It would be likened to us calling that gypsy. The connotation of a Hebrew was they didn't have a home. They moved around. And they couldn't be trusted, according to this vernacular. And so she's saying here that this gypsy you brought in here that I wouldn't trust with my lamppost over here now tried to take advantage of me and mock me. And so, again, that word mock doesn't come up very often either. But to add insult for injury, he tried to fool her. And so Joseph's master put him out of the house and placed him in prison, which, again, makes us kind of understand that Joseph must have been working for Potiphar. He was probably the keeper of this prison. Yes, Jean. I'm sorry to keep going on here. Any questions? Brings up a great point that I haven't thought of is that Potiphar trusted Joseph. But immediately, maybe he trusts his wife more. And there's a problem, too, that he shouldn't have, apparently. Trusted her more over Joseph, but he did. And so his reaction was immediately to solve the problem and throw him into jail. That's a good point. Any other points? I don't have a lot of material here today, so we can certainly field the questions. Excuse me. Once again, I think this is in your commentary, though, a garment of clothing is Joseph undermining. Now think about that for a second. What was the first garment that got Joseph in trouble? The coat of many colors, which really wasn't anything he asked for. It was given to him by who? His father. who did what? Favored him more than the rest of the brothers, which is another story we see back. His mother, Jacob's mother, did to him, Rebekah. This idea of favoritism is, I know, is we have multiple family members. If we're over a household, we try not to do that. But we often get accused of it anyway by our children, that we've played favorites. But here certainly there is. Remember also we talked about there's a blessing and a birthright. And the blessing could be bestowed by the patriarch on any of his children, any of the sons. The birthright was always given to the oldest, though. But we see that changed even here by God. But Joseph, and I didn't capitalize his name here, is given a coat of many colors. And we talked about this was more like a tunic, more like a doctor's coat, probably going down long enough that he couldn't perform duties with this coat on. He would be an overseer of the duties, which was even more insult to his brothers, who, when he went out to find them, was sent out by Jacob. They were in the field doing their duties. And when he shows up, he's got his big coat on. It's more of an insult. And the little brother syndrome certainly comes through today. The little brother better not try any of that on his older brother, or he's going down, right? So here again, we've got the coat that gets Joseph in trouble. And I thought that was very interesting. Joseph was placed in a prison that it was thought to be maybe a round column house in construction. It might have been even attached to Potiphar's structure. It was partly subterranean. We're going to find that out in Genesis 41:14 when he's taken out of prison by Pharaoh. It was thought to be a brick-built wall and maybe have a vaulted roof in form of an inverted bowl, I read. But it was a dungeon, and Potiphar would have been thrown into rage finding out what he did to his wife and ordered him to be subject to the harshest treatment of the other slaves. So this was something that Joseph was now faced with again. Would he be right to say, where's God at? How could God do this to me? What did I do? But it seems that he didn't do any of that. She called the men of her house, disappointed and affronted, and she avowed vengeance and accused Joseph. Seems to be first to the servants and then to the return of her lord, Potiphar. And again she says, he brought this Hebrew in here to mock us. The Hebrew would have been the very abomination to the Egyptians. Psalms, the writer there, probably David, writes about this. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron. So here, through inspiration, he's also put clamps on his legs, which we call fetters. Probably chained by the arms too and thrown into prison. Until the time his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. So here Joseph is being tried. The psalmist says, by the word of the Lord. And I think those scriptures are in your commentary. Again, very interesting that Joseph is tried by the word of the Lord. But the Lord was with Joseph, and he showed him mercy, Now, that's a theme that comes up over and over again in Genesis, doesn't it? The Lord was with Abraham. The Lord was with Isaac. The Lord was with Jacob. The Lord was with Joseph. And the Lord is with us. We can never forget that. And that's one of the other applications to today's lesson. And when we pray, when we ask for help, when we ask for forgiveness, we are part of a royal line, aren't we? The Lord has promised to be with us too. In times of strife, in times of trouble, in times when we don't understand how we got in prison. The keeper of the prison now notices, and this is a story that's going to develop next week. The keeper of the prison starts noticing the qualities of Joseph. And so the keeper of the prison starts giving Joseph special treatment and anything that was under his hand, because the keeper of the prison notices that the Lord was with him. And Joseph being there makes the keeper of the prison prosper somehow. We don't know exactly why, but this is what Genesis, the last verse in this scripture, is saying that we're covering today, is that even the keeper of the prison is blessed by Joseph's presence. Another application: when we're with people, can we be called a blessing, or can we be called a burden? Can we be a blessing to people, or can we be a burden? Which are you? Depends on the day, is that what you said? I think James said it depends on the day. What's that? The mood. Oh, okay, the mood. Yeah, we should never be in a bad mood, but it happens. We're all fallible, and we all have these problems. So here we again, the application I think is in your book, is the providence of God. And we're going to see that even though Joseph is put in these situations, he is devoted to God. Even in a foreign land, he's devoted to God. Even though when he thinks maybe God's not looking or watching, he's devoted to God. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, it says we should never grieve the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed until the day of redemption. We know that scripture, that when we're baptized, we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. We don't do that when we ask Jesus to come in our heart or receive Jesus or accept Jesus. We look back in these scriptures, it's through the baptism, the burial, and when we're placed into Christ, we're baptized into Christ. If any of you's got to watch In Search of the Lord's Way this morning, Tommy and I watched that while we're putting our makeup on and fixing our hair. It's quite convenient. They talked about that this morning. I forget his name now, but he talks about how we're baptized into Christ. And it seems that Joseph is into the providence of God. Also, we're reminded that there's no temptation taken of you such as common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able. And this might have been, this, as we look in the story of Joseph here, we can move that application to everyone has their own weaknesses. In those times, we need to flee from it and pray for God for his deliverance. Any comments so far? I haven't put anybody to sleep yet. Okay, you all look pretty good. Okay, we got some questions now. Gene, you ready? Here we go. What was Potiphar's position in Pharaoh's government?
Captain of the guard.
Officer of Pharaoh. Absolutely. Very good. To what position did Potiphar promote Joseph? What position did...
Overseer of his house.
Exactly right. Boy, I got a good class here. What did Potiphar's wife seek to get Joseph to do? Lie with me. She cast up eyes upon Joseph, so she certainly had a desire there. What piece of evidence did Potiphar's wife present when she accused Joseph? I left the D off there. What piece of, I always see my grammatical errors at the last second here. What piece of Potiphar's, what piece of Joseph's clothing did she present? It was the garment. I left that answer out, I think. What did Joseph say? There's none greater than in this household than I. Kept anything back from thee but thee. In other words, there's nothing that hasn't been given me except for you. Where was Joseph in prison? Mm-hmm. You put him in prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound. How did God bless Joseph after he was in prison? Gene's already reading ahead. Very good. He gave him mercy and favor. And I think there's something there for us to dwell upon, too. And I know I often lose sight of it. We can lose the idea that God has given us mercy. And God has favored us, hasn't he? So, again, a pretty straightforward story, and I have to try to think about, why did God tell me this story? And so these are some of the metaphors that are allegories that come up, this idea of we are placed in places to show honor and glory to God. And in whatever circumstances we find ourselves in, we are to conduct ourselves, even when we're tested, as God would have us to be. Show favor and glory to him, because he shows mercy and favor to us. And certainly tomorrow, that's something to think about. And wherever it shows too that Joseph never lost his faith. A good point. And that's what's hard for us, the everyday challenges of life, our faith can dampen. And we notice back from this line of patriarchs that we have been studying, Abraham and Rachel seem to have at times lost faith. Jacob, Abraham and Sarah, Jacob and Rachel, they all seem to lose faith. But now we see this Joseph, who's going to follow us out of Genesis, who is a metaphor, an allegory for a savior that is going to save the Egyptians from some of the famine that's going to come to them and some of the problems that they will have. And it's all until Joseph passes on that they begin to lose favor. Good point. Any other questions or points, observations? All right, then next week, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise, and it's raining out there today, so we don't know for sure. But if we're here, we're going to study lesson number 9. And that's where Pharaoh promotes Joseph. So Potiphar is going to lose Joseph's blessing. Pharaoh is going to gain him. That's in Genesis 41. So you might read Genesis 40 over the week. Take time every day to study the Bible. It's God's word. It will go into your heart and help you through the struggles of this life, certainly. And next week will be the last lesson, then we're going to get a break and have a new teacher for a couple weeks. Jared's going to be taking over her for a couple classes, so that'll be something to look forward to. Better looking and younger than me, so something to think about. Thank you very much for your patience. Thank you.